On Memorial Day, Americans remember those who have died in military service to the United States. The National Moment of Remembrance is an annual event that asks all citizens, wherever they are at 3 p.m. local time on this national holiday, to pause for a duration of 1 minute in silent tribute to the men and women who have honorably served in uniform and to those who have made the ultimate sacrifice for our nation. Because of the current health crisis, the United States has been forced to cancel almost all memorial ceremonies, wreath laying, cemetery gatherings, and parades. This is a challenging and solemn time in the life of our nation and world, but buglers are rising to the call to honor those who have died in service to our country. We will also remember those who've died of the coronavirus disease. At 3 p.m. local on Memorial Day, hundreds of buglers will be spread out across our nation, from Cape Cod to St. Louis, to San Antonio, to Salt Lake City, to San Francisco, to Alaska and Hawaii, as well as in Australia and Europe, to sound the 24 notes of our most solemn bugle call, taps. They will sound taps on their apartment balcony, from their front porch, driveway, on the sidewalk, and in isolated locations to make sure that this musical tribute is given to those who, as President Abraham Lincoln put it, gave the last full measure of devotion. Please join Taps for Veterans in that national moment of remembrance on this Memorial Day.
On this journey, get lost in my mistakes. Where it looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, my story's just begun. Failure won't define me, cause that's what my father does. Failure won't define me, cause that's what my father does. Well, blue when the father's in the room. Prison doors bring wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the blue when the father's in the room. Oh, One with God, the Lord Most High. You're hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name
Welcome to Grace Baptist Church, and I'm glad you're here joining us again this week. I hope that this is a blessing to you, and I hope that if you need a church, that you would come and give us a try sometime if you're in our area, or if you haven't found a church home yet, and especially with this virus going on and stuff. I know it's been tough for a lot of people, but I appreciate you coming and joining us again. And so I pray God blesses you through the reading of the Word and through me expounding on it a little bit for you. I'm always amazed that people are willing to come and watch me on video, but I'm glad that you are. Today we're going to be in Proverbs chapter 15, verses 12 through 23, and it's kind of an interesting little piece of scripture. And I enjoy Proverbs. They're full of a lot of pithy statements for life. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. But as I was thinking about this, I was thinking about back when I was in high school, and I remember that I got pneumonia really bad, and I missed over a week of school. When I got back, I worked really hard and studied in order to regain the ground that I'd lost. Now, I had a history class, and I had to take a midterm exam in that, and there was one other person in there with me, and afterwards, I was accused by that classmate of cheating. And the teacher now confronted me on this, and I was shocked and even hurt, even though I was able to prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that I had not done so. The teacher's rebuke really kind of stung. Now, receiving a rebuke is never something we really look forward to. And most of us do not like going through one when it happens. I remember one time when I was helping my uncle with my grandmother's garden, and I didn't weed it properly, and he had to rebuke me about the way I did it, and I felt awful about it. He's my favorite uncle, and I love my grandmother a lot. Now, within these pithy statements of Proverbs, we discover over and over again both the rebuke of God and the wisdom of listening to Him as well. And in reading Proverbs, we discover that the Word of God instructs those who love Him. Let's discover, therefore, this morning what that means for our lives. And so, if you have your Bibles, open them up to Proverbs 15, verses 12 through 23, and you can follow along on the screen here if you like. Proverbs 15, verses 12 through 16, and you follow along in whatever version you have. A mocker resents correction. He will not consult the wise. But a happy heart makes a cheerful face. But heartache crushes the spirit. The discerning heart seeks knowledge, but the mouth of a fool feeds on folly. A wise son brings joy to his father, but a foolish man despises his mother. Folly delights a man who lacks judgment, but a man of understanding keeps a straight course. Plans fail for lack of counsel, but with many advisors they succeed. And man finds joy in giving an apt reply, and how good is a timely word. Now, we're going to talk about this. Join me in prayer, if you will. Father God, thank you so much for this morning, for the blessings of the day. And I just pray for those that have joined us on YouTube or Facebook or however they have. And I just pray that you would watch over them. I pray they're safe and Father, they're secure. But I also pray if there's one that has never given their life over to Jesus, they would today. If there's one that is not following you, that they would. And perhaps you'll speak to someone out there about opening up the Word of God and discerning its truth for their life. And so, Father, I pray that this would speak to them, that they would be able to open up their Bibles, whether it's on a cell phone app or their tablet or a regular Bible that they read. Father, I pray that they would do that on a daily basis. For it's in your beautiful name I pray. Amen. Now, I've discovered, and perhaps you have too, it's often easier to be negative on someone than to listen to what they have to say. You know, we can be really negative right off the bat if it's something especially we don't want to hear. And here we learn a beautiful truth from the writer of Proverbs. The first thing we learn is the Word of God instructs those who are willing to listen. You know, you can have a Bible on your coffee table, like I'm going to talk about in a moment, but if you don't open it up and read it, it doesn't do you any good. I'm well reminded of the old adage that states that God gave us two ears and one mouth, and therefore we need to listen twice as much as we're willing to speak. Now, some of us don't follow that. Some of us just rattle on without any thought to the words we use. Now, this is often the problem with our media and politicians. But it also could be a problem with those who feel guilt over their actions or who are caught doing what they shouldn't be doing. And they often protest the loudest, you know. Oh, it wasn't me. I didn't do it. You know, I can remember that with my brother and I when we were caught and we really didn't want to admit to what we were doing. The writer of Proverbs states that a mocker resents correction. Someone who really doesn't believe the Word of God, they say they do, but they really don't, they resent being corrected by it. They resent the wisdom of God. And the Hebrew wording here means someone who scoffs or begins to make excuses for their action without thinking it through. He will not consult the wise, it says. You know, they just rattle on. The correction here, again, is from God, and wisdom that they need to listen to is His. Now, the writer had earlier written in Proverbs a thing that goes like this. It says, whoever corrects a mocker invites insult. Whoever rebukes a wicked man incurs abuse. Do not rebuke a mocker, or he will hate you. Rebuke a wise man, and he will love you. Proverbs 9, 7 through 8. Now, that's kind of interesting, isn't it? See, whoever corrects someone who mocks the Word of God, doesn't really care, they're going to invite insult from somebody. You know, don't ever try using the Word of God with somebody that doesn't know the Word of God, because they're going to dump on you real quick. Whoever rebukes a wicked man incurs abuse, in fact. Do not rebuke a mocker, or he will hate you. Well, that's pretty wise. It really is. However, rebuke a wise man, and he will love you. Proverbs 9, verses 7 through 8 again, like I said before. You see, a wise man who follows the Word of God doesn't mind being taught by the Word of God. In fact, the writer knew that the fear of the Lord is what? The beginning of wisdom. And knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Proverbs 9:10. And this is why we learn here, a happy heart makes the face cheerful, but heartache crushes the spirit. You see, fear of the Lord is beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of God is understanding. Those who love God and follow His ways are happier than those who go their own way and fall into the pitfalls of making excuses over and over and over again for their lives. In a world where it seems everyone has an answer, it can be hard to discern the truth from fiction, especially if one spends too much time on the internet, on Facebook, or Googling for facts. And after all, everything on the internet is true, right? Yeah. Well, like the writer here, I've learned that when we have the words of the Lord for our guide, we can often discern the truth from fiction. If we've applied those words and we're reading it on a regular basis, we can begin to understand what really is a lie and what really is the truth. A heaping dose of godly logic helps. The writer of Proverbs writes that the discerning heart, what, seeks knowledge, but the mouth of a fool feeds on folly. You see, a wise man who follows the Word of God desires that for their life, but a fool only feeds on the folly of their life. In times of stress, we can seek answers but fail to listen to the one, to God Himself, who knows the truth. And like the writer of Proverbs, we need to realize that the Word of God instructs those who are willing to listen to it. Amen? Yeah. Now, I came across a little drinking mug on Amazon the other day, and it had the inscription on it, "You can always tell a German, but you can't tell them much." And it reminded me of my mother, who delighted in teasing my dad by singing a little ditty to him. She would sing, "You can tell a German, you can tell the Dutch, you can tell a German, but you can't tell him much." Adds a little more to it, doesn't it? You see, he came from German ancestry, and of course my mom was Dutch. She was a Van Vliet. We learn, however, that the Word of God instructs those that are willing to listen. Now, it's not just good enough to listen to the Word of God. You have to be willing to also follow it. You have to be willing to be guided by it as well. When I was in the Scouts, one of the things that they taught us is how to use a compass. A compass is important, especially to have in your pack as part of an emergency kit. You know, you have a little like a space blanket or something you can wrap up in, or you have fire starter, you know, you have those kinds of things. And you also would have a compass. But if you don't know how to use a compass is worthless. In some areas in the woods here with all the volcanic rock and stuff, it can be difficult to use a compass. And so you have to kind of know what you're doing. And so the writer of Proverbs, he knew this. You see, the Word of God instructs those who are willing to listen, but you also have to be guided by it. The Word of God gives direction to those who are willing to follow it. Notice what the writer here begins to say. He talks about a relationship in a family, and we're going to elucidate on that a little bit more. The writer turns to the notion of a family unit and relates that a wise son brings joy to his father, but a foolish man despises his mother. Now, that's kind of a curious statement, isn't it? But it reflects how Jewish families worked in that day and age and how individuals relate within a marriage, even in our day and age. Well, let me explain a little bit. Wisdom was highly prized character. It was a highly prized thing that all fathers, especially wanted for their sons. They wanted to have wise sons. Now, don't confuse wisdom with knowledge, because you can have a lot of knowledge and exhibit very little wisdom in life. I was reading an article by a woman who's a Harvard law professor, and some of the things that she said about school and homeschooling just showed me that She may have a lot of knowledge, but she doesn't have a whole lot of wisdom. And wisdom is not necessarily gained by having more knowledge, like I said, unless you're able to wisely use the knowledge you've gained. Now, while a father's desire that they have that their child have wisdom, mothers are always dismayed by the foolishness or the foolish actions of their children, aren't they? When we are deliberately foolish, it shows that we do not care about our mother who raised us. In fact, we disdain her. And as God's children, we are to make him proud of us by how we gain wisdom, not just by how we gain wisdom, but also how we use the wisdom that we've gained. And wisdom, again, for the writer here, remember, comes from where? Comes from God. But those who disdain it appear what? They appear foolish. Foolish. We would say ignorant in our day and age. Some people would even say stupid. My little granddaughter would say, you're not supposed to use the word stupid. But basically, that's what the writer is saying here. Some of these people even go so far as to laugh or think they're being really smart, when in fact, they're really stupid. So the writer says, folly delights a man who lacks judgment, with the idea that a foolish man veers off course in life. Here we go with this compass thing. We learn, however, that a man of understanding keeps a straight course. He stays true to what he's learned from the Lord. You see, the Word of God gives us direction to those of us who are willing to follow it. You know, we can have that Bible on our coffee table, but it doesn't do us any good if we don't open it up. We can have a Bible on our phone app or on our tablet, but it doesn't do us any good if we don't read it once in a while. You see, the Word of God gives directions to those who are willing to follow it. You got to read it and apply it to your life. God can tell us over and over again how we should live, but it's really up to us where we're going to walk. You know, people think, well, you know, God tells me to do this. God says I can't do that and I can't do this and all this. No, God gives you guides to follow, and it's up to you whether you're going to follow them or not. It's up to you whether you're going to be wise or not. I find it difficult, like when folks come to me and they ask for advice, because they usually don't really want to hear what I have to say. They just want me to agree with what they want to do in the first place. But we would do well in seeking the advice of a wise, godly counselor. And notice I said wise, godly counselors. The proverb writer understood this truth and wrote that often plans fail for lack of counsel, but with many advisors, they succeed. Now, this does not mean we go and ask everyone we know. I've known people like that. They just go and ask everybody, and then they get confused. He means we need to act wisely and listen to those who are both godly and wise for what they want to share with us about what we need to do. And notice what he says. A man finds joy, happiness, peace of mind, comfort, all those things, in giving an apt reply. Someone who's godly is more than willing to share with you the wisdom if you're willing to listen to it and follow it. And then he says, and how good is a timely word? You see, if we're willing to listen to the Word of God, if we're willing to listen to wise counsel, it brings joy to our heart, and it's really good for our lives. Amen? You see, the proverb writer teaches us that the Word of God gives direction to those who are willing to follow it. The other day, I was driving down the road, and I saw one of those big old huge motor homes, and it was about the size of a Greyhound bus, and it had a bumper sticker on the back of it with bold letters that proclaimed, "Don't follow me, I'm lost." Now, sadly, that's far truer than some folks would care to admit. One can be lost in the direction that their life is taking and not realize it. But they don't have to be. You don't have to be. You know, maybe you've disdained the Word of God before in your life. Well, maybe it's time for you to begin to open up that Bible app or open up that Bible you have in a drawer and begin to read it for yourself. You know, I wouldn't start at the beginning. Otherwise, you're going to fail right away. You might want to start with like the book of Proverbs or Psalms. And in the New Testament, I'd start with the Gospel of John. Those are beautiful places to start with for anyone. And so I want to encourage you to do that. You know, we can lose direction in our life and not even realize it. And like I said, you don't have to. It's going back to that idea of having a compass in life. And for us, it should be the Word of God. For those of us especially that say we believe in God and we're His children, but it's pretty sad when we don't ever read the Word of God and we don't ever apply it to our lives. How can we say we love God and never read His Word and never apply it to our lives? And Jesus told His disciples, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me, John 14:6. And the idea here, it's kind of an emphatic statement in the Greek. It means that it's almost like a command, but it's also a truth, you know. This is the truth, He's saying. I am the way, and He's literally saying, I'm the only way, I'm the only truth, and I'm the only life, and no one at any time could ever come to the Father, God, except through me, period. You see, Jesus has given us direction for life, and that direction is to come to faith in Him, to ask Him to come into our life. Now, the writer of Proverbs here would say, hey, a wise man listens, but a fool just runs after folly, right? And so we see the Word of God gives direction to those who are willing to follow it. Well, we've learned a couple of things this morning, haven't we? We've learned, number one, that the Word of God instructs those who are willing to listen. You know, like I said before, you can have that Bible on the coffee table or in the drawer next to your bed, in your nightstand or whatever, or you can have a Bible app on your phone or your tablet, but if you never open it up and read it, it's not doing you any good. It just isn't, you know? And so you have to be willing to listen to it. You have to be willing to read it and apply it to your life. And number two, he tells us the Word of God gives direction to those who are willing to follow it. You want direction in life? You want to know what God truly desires? You want to know the answers for life? Now, especially during this time when we're facing a lot of stress and some of you may be out of work and, you know, and you're really frustrated. Why would God allow this to happen? Well, you may not have the direction in your life that you need. And so I want to encourage you to open up that Bible, to open up that Bible app and begin to read it for yourself. The Word of God instructs those who are willing to listen. The Word of God gives direction to those who are willing to follow it. Are you willing to do that today? I pray that you are. Would you join me in prayer? Father God, I just pray for those that listen to the Word today and that they would apply it to their life and they would use it as a direction for their life. And I pray again for those that need to know you, that they would come to know you and give their life to you. And Father, they don't need to know the Bible. They don't need to even understand it all. All they need to know is that they just need you, because that is truly the beginning of wisdom and relationship with you. And so, Father, I would pray that also for those of us that have Bibles or Bible apps and we've never opened them up, or we very rarely open them up, that we would begin to do that, that we would begin to seek your Word for our lives, that we would start in Psalms or Proverbs, the Gospel of John, and we begin to apply that to our life. Father God, you teach us and instruct us, for it's in your beautiful name we pray. Amen. I pray for you today, and if you have received Christ as your Savior and Lord, or you want to draw closer to the Lord, or if you even want to have a way to read the Bible through, you can contact me, and I'll give you some good advice if you're willing to listen to it. I'm willing to send you some things that you might need in life. May God bless you. May you just know His joy. And until we could come together as a church and as a family of God, may you be kept safe. God bless you all, and thank you again for being a part of this. For it's in His beautiful name I pray. Amen.